Cool. So my name's Chris, and today I'm here to talk to you about breaking things. For a little bit of background, I work at a payments company called GoCardless as a site reliability engineer. What GoCardless does is provide an API that lets merchants do things like make a HTTP request, say post to cash monies amount 100. We collect the money from their customer and we transfer it to them, and everyone's generally happy about their lives. Because of what we do, we place a relatively high value on each request. It's not something like a social media post or something similar where if you lose it, it's not the end of the world. We're talking about people's money here, so they tend to get very antsy if things aren't working properly. Now, it can cause merchants to lose customers if we fail while they're in the middle of, say, a checkout flow. So if they're about to like purchase an online subscription and the merchant tries to send something to our API and we fail, their customer may like see the failure and just like never come back, and they've lost money. If we do that really often, we start to lose merchants because like they're not happy with us and they expect their payments provider to work something like electricity or gas. It's like super like plumbing level stuff. So for us, uptime is key. If we go down too often, our merchants lose money. And if we do that, then we lose merchants. You're probably gonna have different concerns to us. Like, everyone in this room works at different companies with different constraints and different things that their customers expect of them. But I think there are some common ideas that we can extract from the times we've failed to be up and available that probably apply to a lot of people's different situations. Today, I'm gonna be talking about distributed systems as a whole. Not just Postgres by itself, but Postgres plus the applications that actually use it, regardless of what language they're written in. In our case, that's a bunch of Rails apps that talk to Postgres, and our stack is fairly typical of a startup from the last like 5 or so years. There's other supporting tech, but none of it really matters in this talk. Unsurprisingly, I'm gonna focus on Postgres. We're gonna look a little bit at Rails and some weird stuff that that does in its interactions with Postgres, but everything that I talk about is not really like framework specific. We use Postgres as our authoritative store of all the data that matters. Every record of a payment, of a transaction that goes through our system, goes into Postgres, and we treat that as like the truth. So for us, it has to be a store that we can trust. And broadly, like Postgres is. Like, it's really good at keeping your data. It's really well documented, and it tends to do what it says in the docs. Occasionally though, we'll get into a little fight. Something will go wrong, and our expectations will be broken. This talk is about those bumps in the road. And what we're gonna do is a little bit of learning through the medium of postmortems. Now, postmortems are something that we believe in really strongly at GoCardless, and while it's fun to like chat war stories and whatever, the really valuable thing is what you learn and how you improve when you come out of them. If you're not familiar with postmortems, I recommend Etsy's article on this, and I will be posting all the slides so you can grab the links later. But that's a really good description of how they run postmortems at their company. All of it boils down to this. We believe that failure can be a great teacher, and you're a fool if you throw that like potential lesson away. So I'm gonna give you a best of our incidents, the 5 best downtimes we've had. They break into 3 categories. The first one is about running out of a resource on a box, CPU, memory, disk, whatever. The third incident is about weird interactions between your ORM or database driver and the database itself. And the last two are around running clusters of highly available databases. For each of those incidents, I'm going to talk about what happened. I'm going to pull out something we learned. I'm going to try and give you some ideas that you can take away and use. I'm gonna summarize at the end with 3 things that I think you should definitely do, and there'll be a little bit of time for questions, and then I'll be around in the hall for lunch as well. So, let's get started by talking about running out of resources. Incident number 1, the fast migration that wasn't fast. This was the first time that I caused a complete outage of GoCardless in production, so it stuck in my mind pretty well. For a little bit of background, we will make roughly 10 to 20 schema changes per month. Sometimes this dips down to like 5 or so. I don't think it's ever gone much beyond 20. And in this, I'm including everything from creating a new table to back like a new feature, like subscriptions or plans, adding a column to a table for similar reasons, or adding an index to an existing column to fix a performance issue that you've hit. It fluctuates, but it usually falls into that range. The problem with schema changes is that they typically hold exclusive locks. They need to modify the actual structures of the database, and they need nothing else touching those structures while they do it. The issue is, if you have exclusive locks and they're long held, nothing else can use your database. There's plenty of guides on the internet on how to not put yourself into that situation, how to make sure your database schema migrations are fast. There's three bits that come up all the time. The first, don't add columns with defaults. If you add a column with a default on a large table, Postgres is going to sit there holding an exclusive lock on the table while it rewrites the entire thing with the new column. That's bad if you've got millions or billions of entries in a table, because nothing else can touch that table for the time. The second thing is to validate any constraints you add after adding them. In Postgres 9.4 and above, this does not hold an exclusive lock on the table while it validates that the constraint actually holds. So it's generally something that you want to do. Lastly, add any indexes concurrently. What this means is that Postgres will hold a weak index while it builds the a weak lock while it builds the index, so the rest of your traffic can continue normally. So following these rules, this migration seems fine. We want to add a refunded Boolean onto payment so that our merchants can now issue refunds and send the money back to the customer. Seems pretty easy. We're adding a column. It's not got a default, so this can't cause any kind of problem, right? Well, as I learned on that day, there's this thing where locks can get queued if they can't be acquired. It turns out that when a lock can't be granted, the query enters a queue to acquire that lock. Anything that would also conflict with that lock will queue up behind it. So let's look at some sample queries. Let's say we have a query that's select all of the customers that have ever made a payment through GoCardless. This is run-of-the-mill analytics. You want to see maybe how many customers you have, who it is, who your customers who sign up but never make a payment are, that kind of analysis. You then deploy your new feature, which is refunds. But this has to wait behind the analysis query, which is taking quite a while to run because it's a select distinct. What that means is that your regular API queries, such as viewing a single payment, no longer work. They have to queue up behind that thing that's grabbed trying to grab the exclusive lock on the table. What that means is that your API is down. And in this case, we had a total outage of about 15 seconds, where critical parts of our API, payments, were no longer available. So what was going on here? What was the core of the problem? The issue is that we were kind of mixing these two different loads on our database. The first one, that select distinct customers query, is something called online analytical processing. Generally, this refers to when you're performing aggregation over larger data sets. Generally, these queries are slower. They operate over a ton of data, and they look a bit different to your regular API queries. Our regular API queries are generally in the category of online transaction processing. They operate over a small number of rows, and they don't try and perform aggregation functions on the whole. So something we decided after this was, don't OLAP where you OLTP. Move that OLAP load away from your database, your primary database server that's serving API traffic. There's actually very little reason to do that sort of analysis there. You can easily do it on a replica, or you can move it out to some data warehouse or Google BigQuery or whatever if you're feeling fancy. It doesn't need to be loaded on your primary database server. We also learned that it's always wise to set appropriate bounds on your system. Now, this is a slide that we're going to get super familiar with by the end of the talk. Now, pretty much every postmortem that I'm going to run through, we run into something like this. It is better for you to set a bound on some part of the system, for that part of the system to fail in an expected way, than for you to set no bounds and the system still to fail, but in a way that you don't understand, the whole thing falls over. In this case, we started setting these two things on all of our schema migrations, lock timeout and statement timeout. What this means is that if a schema migration is waiting to acquire a lock, as we saw before, it will give up after, in our case, 750 milliseconds, meaning that all the regular API traffic that was behind it in the queue can go through and there's no problem. Now, sure, your schema migration failed, but it is less critical for you to deploy a new version of your software than it is for your API to stay up. You can get your developers to deploy a bit later in the day or whatever, but fundamentally you want your system to be there rather than your new version to be out. We went into way more detail in a blog post on this. So again, I'll be posting the slides later. If you're really interested in this one, we've got a full write-up of it. We've also open sourced that little piece of code that inserts those timeouts around every schema migration. It drops straight in if you're using Ruby on Rails, but also you can probably like rip it off in any framework you're using because it's like 100 lines of code tops. We also have a wish list. So what we do there is we set timeouts on lock acquisition and on a statement level, but locks actually pile up as you if you begin a transaction. So every statement you run inside a transaction keeps the locks that it was granted. What we'd really like is a way of saying set a timeout on this entire transaction, because what could happen is you have someone does like begin transaction, then runs a schema change that's quick, then runs something that's really slow, and the exclusive lock on the schema change is still like there blocking queries. There's something that looked a little bit like this in 9.6, but it's only for idle connections, which isn't exactly what we want here. Also, turn this setting on, log lock waits. What this will give you is visibility into any time your database is waiting on a lock, so you can get a general impression of how contended your database is. Cool. Incident number two. Do we just use 1.5 terabytes of disk? Answers on a postcard. So this one started off with an alert that really got our attention. For background, like we do not have big data. Generally, like as a payments company, your records are fairly small. You're not like trawling the web for like everything and building an index of it. You've got like records of payments that happened. So until you hit like mega scale, you won't have anything that I would actually classify as big data. To be clear about that, I'm talking about our data is measured in gigabytes, not terabytes. We had previously to this incident spent about 2 hours chasing what looked like just totally random timeouts between our services, and we couldn't connect a pattern to them. We were starting to pull our hair out, and then we got an alert saying, hey, your Postgres thing has gone over 1.5 terabytes of disk. When we looked at the graph, we saw this. At some point in the day, something had started chewing up disk on Postgres like nothing else, and like, this is a really horrible alert to receive, because like somewhere a little bit up there beyond where the graph ends is how much disk you actually have, and we don't want to hit that. So something wrong had happened earlier in the day to cause us to start chewing up disk. When we went back to the log files from Postgres, we saw some lines that we'd missed. Postgres was creating a ton of temporary files for some reason that we didn't know. Now, the reason we've missed these is that we were looking through the logs for stuff that we already knew about. We were looking for slow queries and stuff like that using grep and like missing what the actual problem was because we didn't look at the logs as a whole. So what was it this time? It was a runaway analytics query again. In this case, someone was trying to add a breakdown of how merchants were using our API. So like what different features they were using the most, and it would generate like an email to send to developers to like let them look at that whenever they fancied. The problem is that that joined across like many tables to do so. It was going from everything from like merchant through their payments, through their agreements with customers, through like absolutely everything. The result of that join materialized into memory was massive, and therefore Postgres started backing it down onto disk in order to provide the result. So once again, don't OLAP where you OLTP. We were bitten by basically the same problem. And like after this, we really started to like shift more and more of our workload off to like data warehouse instead. So again, we saw this problem of queries operating over large data sets interacting poorly with queries operating over small data sets. We were lucky in that this was a near miss. We managed to cancel the query before it hit the like line of doom at the top of that graph. And then we got some time to like really think about this and you know come up with something that would stop it happening again. Once again, we set appropriate bounds on the system. In this case, a flag called temp file limit, which is a size in kilobytes of the maximum size of temporary files created per Postgres session or connection. What this does is it shields your service from rogue queries. It means that no one connection can just sit there and fill up the entire disk of your Postgres server, which is a good thing to do. But there is a caveat that comes with this. Generally speaking, your data is going to grow over time. I don't know of companies where the opposite of this is true, Please tell me if you know of one, because I'd be kind of curious. The bits that of your system that are liable to break when you set this are things that aggregate large bits of data together. Now, in our case, this was our payment submission run, which happens at some point during the day and has to like aggregate everything that wants to be submitted at once. Again, that's kind of an OLAP thing, but because we want to do it over like fairly live data, like payments that have actually been created today, we couldn't do that off a data warehouse. So this was something that broke for us when we added our temp file limit. And we had to bump our temp file limit accordingly and optimize some of those queries to not need temp files. So be a little bit wary when turning this on. Like, some stuff is going to break and some stuff may break down the line. What I would recommend is instrumenting your server for like how much temp files are we using, getting that into graphs, setting an alerting threshold and of whatever your temp file limit is, and then being like, oh, sorry, a bit before it. And then you will know before this is a problem. Cool. So you want to measure these things as you approach your limits. If you're setting a limit, you probably want an alarm at like 90% of that limit or whatever. There's one more caveat. Index creation uses temporary files. So whatever you set as your temp file limit is instantly the largest index you can create, which is frustrating because you may have some fairly large tables. The way around this is to disable temp file limit during your schema migrations. So much like we wrapped timeouts around our schema migrations, you can set temp file limit to -1 to disable it, do your migration, and then re-enable it. This requires superuser, so you're going to have like privileged connections that your schema migrations run through just for this purpose. Cool. So our first two examples have focused mostly on Postgres behaviors. I'd like to move on to those interactions between ORMs and database drivers and Postgres itself. And while this may feel like a little bit of a detour at primarily a databases conference, I think it's important to remember that like our users care about the combined behavior of the database and the app. Postgres might be singing along happily in the background, but if the app can't use it, then like users don't really care what's broken. They just know that your service is down. So, incident 3, revenge of the ORM. Let's start by starting a company. Say you've chosen Postgres as your main data store, and you have a couple of clients, and they're like a Rails app or whatever. You don't have mega scale, so you don't need many clients. So your startup starts to have a little bit of success, and you have to add more clients. As this goes on, you realize that because Postgres uses a process per connection, this is quite expensive in terms of memory. So you want to get better utilization out of your Postgres box, or otherwise you're going to have to provision one with like a lot of memory. The typical solution to this is to deploy a proxy called PG Bouncer in transaction pooling mode. The way that mode works is it takes many client connections and it multiplexes the queries coming over those down into a smaller number of connections down into Postgres. The guarantee it provides you is that if you begin a transaction, it will stick you to a backend connection and not like switch you between them. Otherwise, transactions will be completely broken. For everything else, though, there's no guarantee of which backend connection you're going to hit, which means you lose access to session-level features. There are bits of Postgres you have to stop using. The three main ones are setting session-level variables. Setting transaction level is fine. Session-level advisory locks, if they're something you use. And prepared statements. You have to stop using prepared statements from your app. Now, you still can use like bind parameters, but you lose the advantages of caching of statement query plans and stuff like that. So we went through and prepared our apps for this, made sure we weren't using any of those features, and in the places where we had to, for example, when we were setting those timeouts on like lock acquisition, those have to go through dedicated connections to Postgres because PG Bouncer isn't compatible with them. And we thought we were good. We switched over to transaction pooling because we were starting to run into a bit of a scalability wall with our current Postgres setup. And then the next day, we started seeing this in our exception tracker. So if you don't speak Ruby, this is a null pointer exception. And it's saying, I just tried to call the method fields, and it was on a null object. Now, this was coming from deep down inside of the database drivers, like PG, which binds onto libpq. So something really funky was going on. If you Google for this error message, the entire internet tells you to disable prepared statements. Now, we'd been through all of our apps. We'd already done this. We went through again and like double and triple checked. we were definitely not using prepared statements anymore. So this one was going to be down to us. We ended up sinking 3 days of three people's time into fixing this problem. And like, that may seem like a lot, but we basically had no choice. We were either going to enable this feature or run into a scaling wall and start having to spend like inordinate amounts of money adding more and more RAM into our Postgres servers. So we had to find out what was going on here. It wasn't an option just to like pump this to the backlog. Digging further, we noticed that this was happening more when we deployed applications and when constraints were violated, such as a unique index or anything of that kind. We finally started to like lose our minds, and we decided that we would locally boot up Postgres and our application stack while running TCP dump and like looking at it through Wireshark. And while we didn't strictly need those, we got our answer. There were a bunch of extra statements going down the connection that we weren't sending. This was what was going on. And those were running like just after the connection was established, before we actually sent any of our app queries. Those middle three really stand out. For some reason, it's changing the level of error message that the client receives to panic, the highest level of error. Then it's trying to enable standard conforming strings, which if you're not familiar with it, because it's not really a thing, it's enabled by default now, is there's like non-standard conforming strings and standard conforming strings, and you generally want strings that conform with the standard because that's good. so Rails is trying to enable that. And then it sets the error level back down to warning. So it's really weird that we're seeing these there. And the reason that Rails does those three statements is that standard conforming strings is only something you can set on or off in Postgres 8.2 or above. And Rails has this to make it to be compatible with 8.1 and below. So it was saying, don't tell me about any errors. Try this thing that might cause an error. OK, now tell me about errors again. Let's see how that interacts with PG Bouncer. Let's go back to our diagram and simplify down to a single client, because that's all we need to trigger this. We're going to set that level to panic and then down to warning. The first statement goes down backend connection number one. The second statement goes down backend connection number two. Because we're not inside a transaction, there is no guarantee that you're going to stick to an individual backend. So what happens if you leave client min messages set to panic? It turns out a whole bunch of useful stuff that you want to hear about, like constraint violations, is no longer reported to the client. What this means is that the client connection is left in a bad state, and the next thing that comes along is going to error out in a really super weird way, like that nil error we saw before. So what was the fix? It turns out, by their own policy, Rails didn't even care about this anymore. They were not maintaining compatibility with Postgres 8.1 because it was 2016. Like, that was not a thing they had to care about anymore. So we removed this code from Rails, and they were happy about that, and the bug stopped happening. So that was all cool. We also wrote a detailed write-up of this. So again, if you want to go and read in like full depth, and there's links off to all the different bits of stuff we had to look into, then go right for it. Something that was really cool was that Rick Branson, who used to work at Instagram, had seen this same thing with Django and PG Bouncer. Django was also issuing session level things, and when they switched to PG Bouncer with transaction pooling, they ran into very similar problems. So it's not just the Rails ORM that's causing these problems, it's like fairly widespread. So what did we learn? There's a lot more to running a database reliably than user bin Postgres. Our stack is just Rails and Postgres, but in debugging this, we had to understand what PG Bouncer was doing. We had to dig through libpq. We dug through Ruby's PG gem, which is the bindings into libpq, and we dug through Rails' ORM active record. Like, if you're going to start running Postgres and understanding how it's behaving in prod, you've got to get comfortable with other people's code. And you want to remember that it's just code, it's not magic. Like, especially when things are open source, this is a really easy thing to do. You can go to like GitHub or wherever, pull the code and like start pulling it apart. And if you're really stuck, you can probably ask the author for some help. Like, they will explain things to you in general. Like, I've had a lot of success with that. Also, don't trust the ORM. Like, the great thing about frameworks is that they do so much about you. But like, the awful thing about frameworks is they do so much for you. Like, there's never like a good surprise when you find out that your framework is doing something. You usually mean like, oh, I was really surprised by that behavior in a bad way. So that's all I'm gonna like talk about Rails today and ORMs in general. The final section is about running highly available databases. Everything I've talked about before this applies to a single Postgres node. Now, if you care about availability, you do not run a single node of anything because that's kind of, you know, a bad time. In this case, I'm going to talk about two incidents where instead of providing higher availability, our cluster actually reduced our availability. Generally, running highly available clusters is trying to answer these two questions. How soon are we back online, and is all our data there? You want to be able to answer soon and yes. Cluster is a super opaque word. Like, it doesn't really tell you anything about what's going on. So I'm going to boil it down to like four pieces that I think are essential to clustering. The first is consensus, some way of the nodes agreeing on the state of the world. The second is a state machine, some way of each node modeling the state of the world outside of it, and the nodes agree on that state by using the consensus mechanism. Health checks. The nodes need to be able to understand if the other nodes are up and agree on whether one of them should be primary or not right now. And lastly, you need some sort of scripted actions that can be triggered whenever you have a state change. So say I have a state change from healthy to unavailable for a node, and that node happens to be primary, I want to run the scripted action that is promote new node. I'll say this is a mostly true simplification. Clustering is way more complex than I can get through in those four points, but it serves enough for what I'm going to talk about. For clustering, we use a tool called Pacemaker. It's kind of a generic clustering tool that you can plug different scripts in to make it compatible with different bits of software. We use the out-of-the-box PGSQL script, but there are also scripts for MySQL and a whole bunch of other tools. So, incident four. Sorry, I cannot hear you. I'm kind of busy. And this one starts with us getting paged. Our API had gone down, and we'd been alerted to that. When we looked at the rest of our alerts and monitoring, we saw this. This is basically saying that the cluster had decided to demote the current primary and move it to a new node. During that time, while we're moving to a new primary node, our API is unavailable because we can't access like any data. The reason it had decided that the current primary was unhealthy was that it had replied, sorry, I've got too many clients connecting to me already. Now, this was kind of surprising to us because we thought we'd provisioned the right number of connections everywhere so that we couldn't run into situations like this, especially not for something like a cluster health check, which should be running through a privileged connection so it doesn't get affected by applications. We had about 30 seconds of downtime while the primary was moved over to a new node, but then everything came back, so we were in an okay state by the time we were actually reacting to stuff. In order to stop this from happening again, we rolled back a change that we had just deployed to the infra. We'd provisioned a bunch of new asynchronous workers into a new app infrastructure that we were starting to use. So we figured we've probably put like something wrong there or like something bad. Spin those down, because it's async work. It doesn't really matter if you're not processing it quickly enough right now. And we started to investigate from there. The cause? It turned out to be really obvious and like just a dumb mistake. I mentioned earlier that some of our things need a way of connecting directly to Postgres and not through PG Bouncer. And we have a flag that says use direct PG connection, true or false. We had accidentally provisioned all of these asynchronous background workers to go directly to Postgres. And Postgres was mighty unhappy about this, to say the least. As I mentioned, you'll be saying that, what about your super user reserved connections? Like, why didn't that save you? It turns out we'd miscalculated. Let's run with an example of 100 connections, just because it's a nice round number. We need four super user connections to run our things. We've got a couple of replication connections, one for health checks, one for backups. So let's say the apps are using 70 connections. There are 26 free in the pool. And we've got those four spread across three reserved connections and one non-reserved connection. And the reason for that is that three is the default number of reserved connections for super users, and we hadn't changed it. Whoops. So, under load, once we told everything to go directly to Postgres, you hit 97 connections on the app. Your three reserved connections get used, and then, unfortunately, the health check gets rejected because there are no more connections left. So, the same lessons again. Set appropriate bounds on your system. In this case, rather than having to limit a resource, we hadn't thought ahead enough to reserve a resource for an important process. Now, I think the only real way to foresee situations like this is to properly comb through the config files of anything you're going to deploy. Really, this was because we'd gone this default is probably fine, rather than thinking about, okay, what are all the really important super user privileged processes that we have? Have we set aside enough connections for them? Planning pays off. Cool. So the next incident is kind of intense, so I'm just going to give you a government mandated break and take a sip of water. Cool. Incident 5, what's in a health check? Our second clustering incident is much more complex than the previous one, and it was way more difficult to debug. This time, there were plenty of connections available, and to figure it out, we're going to have to look deep into what goes on during those health checks. If we massively simplify how the health checks run, the way Pacemaker does it is it uses Sue to change down to the Postgres user on each node, and it runs some sort of query against the node individually. It then aggregates those results and decides what to do. In reality, it runs a bunch of queries that check things like, is this node the primary or a replica, and individual stuff about replication state. But we can reproduce this bug by just doing a select now on all of our nodes as the health check. So we have a rule at GoCardless, which is that for user accounts, we put humans into LDAP, because it's generally easier to manage than having to reprovision everything onto your boxes. But robot accounts, such as Postgres, live locally on each machine. So the reason we do that is that we never want a downtime in LDAP to turn into a downtime of gocardless.com. Those two things should be separate failure domains. So following that rule, Postgres is a robot account. You never need to reach out to LDAP to resolve this account. So it should be fairly safe to just restart your LDAP nodes at will, right? Your users won't be able to reach anything, but it's fine. The API is going to be up or not. We were rolling out some upgrades to LDAP, and during that, we had our Postgres cluster hit a timeout on its health check. And when it hit the timeout, it decided to transition to a new primary node, in spite of Postgres being healthy. The way this command works is that the pacemaker daemon runs it and sues down from root into Postgres. Now, despite of everything I've just told you, when LDAP became unavailable, this command blocked. And it turns out that the command itself didn't matter. You can sue down into Postgres and echo hello, and it's still going to block. So what was going on? We turned to some of my favorite debugging tools, strace and ltrace. The way strace works is it attaches to a process and prints every system call that process makes. Ltrace is the same, but for C library calls. This may be a little bit controversial, but I think these are probably the two quickest and best tools you can learn for your debugging toolkit. The reason I think that is that they're extremely general. They will follow you to any programming language you use. They're totally agnostic of what you're writing, but they tell you a lot about what your program is doing. If you're not that familiar with them, I think a cool starting point is Julia Evans' articles online. The one I've linked to is a zine that she drew of how to use strace and how it's cool. So we ran them and looked specifically for anything to do with user and login calls, and these ones stood out. Get UID returning 0, which is root, and get login returning Chris, which is me, which seems really unusual because I'm not the pacemaker cluster, so that's okay. So what does getLogin do? Let's look at the man page for that. So according to the man page, getLogin returns the username associated by the login activity with the controlling terminal of the current process, which is super clear, and we all know what that means. The two interesting bits of information there are username, so it's a username string rather than a UID, and login activity. Now, login activity is something that follows whoever initially started a session down through any sub-processes they start it. And to show this, I wrote a tiny C program which printed out the result of getLogin. When I run it as me, it returns Chris. When I sudo up and then run it again, it still returns Chris because that's followed me through the session. Linux stores this in two places, var run utemp and proc peered login UID. And let's have a look at what that is currently set to for our pacemaker cluster. So we find the process ID of pacemaker D. We look at its login UID, and instantly that does not look like root. And predictably, we run getent on it, and it's me. Like, what? Like, seriously, it's me? Like, this is deeply worrying. So it turns out that if you log into your system, and at least this holds true for Ubuntu and Upstart, and you restart a service such as Pacemaker, your user becomes permanently associated with that service until it is next started because of this whole login activity thing. So what is Sue actually doing here? Why does it use getlogin? It turns out like the code is kind of subtle. Like what it's doing is it's trying to get the passwd struct for the calling user. So the reason it needs to know about the like password struct is it needs to, one, allow root to sue down to any other account, and two, it needs to like authenticate you if you're not root and say like, hey, actually, can you like supply like a password or whatever. So let's step through this in pseudocode. I've replaced the calls with some things that are, like, I think are slightly more readable, because like not everyone's going to know the Unix login stack that well. So first off, let's say Sue is like getting the UID of the current running user. So it's zero, it's root. Get login returns me, which is frustrating. It then calls a method which gives you the password struct by name. So it's passing Chris into that. Then it's comparing the UID in that password struct with the UID it got from get UID, which is not the same. Now the step before that, password from name, is where we blocked earlier. So I can't really see when this conditional is going to be true, particularly if I'm like the one who's associated with the login. So what it ends up doing is calling a method that gives you the password struct by UID, which is zero for root. So what situation is the first side of that conditional useful in? Only if you have duplicate UIDs is this ever actually going to return you a different password struct, which to me feels like a really weird way to set up a system. Like I've never in my life done that, and I generally don't like things that collide on IDs. It feels weird. And like this whole notion of login activity doesn't feel like what Sue actually wants in reality. So I'm not sure why it's using that. It feels very disconnected from the thing that is actually controlling the process. Last time I gave this talk, I had to wave my hands here and say like, maybe there's reasons, and then like peace out and leave the room. This time I got to do some more digging. It turns out you can trace the lineage of this code in Sue back to FreeBSD to at least 1994. The reason I can't go beyond 1994 is that that comes from an import from SCCS, which I do not have on my laptop and do not know how to use. So I would have to go down into the BSD 4.4 repos or before then to actually track down where this code is introduced. So I went to the FreeBSD hackers mailing list, and they were super helpful. Like, I got a ton of responses on the same day I asked the question. So it turns out there are reasons, and we have some answers. The first one, which I didn't hit in Linux, but makes a ton of sense in FreeBSD, is that they have an account called Tor, which is root, spelled backwards. The reason they have that account is that lots of people want to customize things, like the shell that gets used and whatever, but they generally favor not doing that to the actual root account in case you introduce like a broken shell or something, because you might totally lock yourself out of the system at that point, which is a bad time. So Tor is also UID 0, but you can change its entry in etc password to say like, use my fancy ZSH or whatever you want. It turns out other people are doing the same thing or similar. This one person responded to say that they are running like a bunch of mailing lists and they use different Unix mail accounts for each user. Now, they didn't want the faff of setting up like file permissions or ACLs or like a shared group or whatever, so they just used the same UID all over, which is kind of fair. If this is like something that's an expected behavior of the system, feel free to use it. I still find the whole like duplicate UIDs thing a little bit weird. Lastly, someone linked me to this really cool repo that's been put together, which details the history of Unix. I've not had a chance to go like looking through it yet, but someone's gone all the way through the old Unixes and like put together the history going forward to FreeBSD as of today. And like, I really enjoy geeking out on what I'd like to call code archaeology. It's like, I think it's super cool being able to trace what we have now back to like the 1970s. And it also can be useful in answering questions like the ones we hit in these incidents. And a bit of me wonders if in like 50 or 100 years, this will literally be a job title. So we need to fix our setup. And one more time, the answer was to set appropriate bounds on the system. In this case, we set an LDAP timeout, which was much smaller than our health check timeout, which meant that in the case it couldn't get to LDAP, it would just fall back straight to the local user, everything would be fine, and we wouldn't falsely fail over the cluster. We saw again that there's a lot more to our stack than user bin PostgreSQL. In this case, we had to understand the entire Unix login stack, including LDAP. So you've kind of got this weird like distributed system behavior inside another distributed system, and it all combines to like take you down. Another cool thing, I think, is like running game days. Now, if you're not familiar with game days, they're basically trying to answer questions like, what happens if I turn this service off? Running like actual game days where you go and switch things off will help you to surface problems that you basically won't find in any other way. You have to run them on some sort of representative infrastructure. Now that could be, that can be production. Generally, you want to start with like staging environments, and then eventually you can go like full Netflix mode and use like Chaos Monkey and stuff like that to start taking things out in production as well. Again, we have published a blog post about this very recently. So this details exactly how we run game days at GoCardless, and hopefully it's kind of useful for anyone who wants to run similar exercises. So that's all our postmortems. I promised you I'd give you three bits of advice that you could take away and do something with. The first one is check your logs. There was a ton of interesting context in a lot of our incidents, which we would have got if we'd have like taken a look properly into our logs rather than just passing them by. You probably have too much stuff in there to extract noise on a day-to-day basis, but there are tools that will help you, such as PG Badger, and aggregation tools like Kibana or Elasticsearch. The next one is set appropriate bounds on your system. When you're configuring something new, take a read through its config file and look for anything that looks like you may want to set like some sort of limit somewhere. It's just generally a good thing to do. Lastly, do not trust your ORMs and database drivers. Go ahead and fire that up locally in development against a Postgres database and just like see what it does, because maybe it will surprise you like Django and Rails did. You'll notice that none of these are about clustering. I think it's hard to give generalized advice about running HA clusters, at least in a little wrap-up like this. And frankly, a lot of people now use hosted service for clustering. Lastly, I've got a couple of thoughts just to sort of close up. Operating a database is about much more than the database itself. We saw this slide a couple of times, and I think it's so true. You never want to think of Postgres just by itself. You want to think about it in the context of the distributed system that you're actually running. Lastly, this is one of my favorite tweets ever. It's from a guy called Scott Andreas, who's saying that not once have I regretted spending unbounded amounts of time investigating something fishy. I think if you care about reliability of your systems, you generally want to have this attitude. You find something fishy and you dig into it, you will learn things, you will improve your knowledge, and you will improve the reliability of your systems. Thank you. So just before I launch into questions, we are hiring for site reliability engineers. So if you want to do this kind of stuff and much more, and you like building reliable stuff, come chat. But now the real thing, questions.
So all the outages that you spoke about were less than a minute. We're talking about seconds.
Yes.
How many transactions are we talking about here? And was any of it at peak time?
So can't give exact, sorry. So the question was how many transactions are we talking about in these less than a minute outages? I can't give exact numbers on each one. What was the second part of your question, sorry?
How many transactions do you process a second?
Okay, so our transactions per second number isn't public, as of yet. But yes, oh sorry, to the second bit, which was, is this at peak times? Yes, it has been at peak times. Question at the back?
Several of your variance equations are all kind of around automatic failover. Is there any reason to run a
Cool. Yeah, so the question was around, have we considered like using manual failover, as in two of the incidents we had auto failover actually taking us down? There are like empirically more situations where the auto failover has saved us, and like we've stayed up, or we've been back up more quickly than we would have been if we'd like page an ops person in the middle of the night to do the failover. So like we're going to stick with it, but yeah, I totally get the point of like, this is a risky thing, and you generally don't want auto failover to be too aggressive. It's something you want to tune, is like your timeouts on when it considered a node to be unhealthy, for example. So yes, it is a balance, I agree with you, but I don't think going back to manual failovers is suitable for us. Cool, can't see any more. So if you want to chat like just like more relaxed, I'll be out in the hall anyway. So thank you all very much.